Hello, you all. We'll be starting in a few moments, but I'd love you all, if you have a chance, grab a square sheet of origami paper or just a square sheet of paper for our exercise that we will be doing soon. I'm going to do some hands-on today. Hello, you all. We'll be starting momentarily. We are so happy to have you all here today. We are from Teaching Artists Guild. I am Miko Lee. I, for visual description, am a middle-aged Asian American woman with mid-length black and purple hair. I'm wearing a pink coral necklace, and I have a sort of peachy the background behind me with some art hanging on the wall. We are so thrilled that you are here to join us today with Teaching Artists Guild. Today, our workshop in our series of BIPOC youth-led workshops is arts-inspired youth justice movements. And we have some amazing young people with y'all today. We just want to give a shout out to the Fenwick Foundation and the Pantaria Fund for helping to support this series. We really wanted to hear from the young people that we are working with, that we are serving, and that we deeply believe are our future. And so that's what our series is all about. It's co-curated along with Memphis Music Initiative and Arts Corps. And we are Teaching Artists Guild. If you are not on our asset map, you should be. Please get on there so you could get work, so that you could collaborate, so that you could join with us. Also, grab a sheet of paper before we get started, a square sheet of paper or a piece of origami so that you can join us. So I want to go on to the next slide. Thank you so much, Melissa Park, for backing me up and throwing stuff into the chat. Please, y'all, use the chat. The chat is where it's at. We're gonna do questions at the very end of the time today. We have some really brilliant youth presenters, and we have ASL interpretation by Pro Bono ASL. You'll see on the screen right now is Susan Pacheco Correa and Rion Perkins. And Rion, we are working on getting you spotlighted as well. Having a little technical difficulties there. And today we present some really brilliant and wonderful young folks. Yes, please rename yourself with your pronouns and throw in what territories you are calling in from. I am calling in from the territories of the Ohlone peoples whose land I reside on in Berkeley, California, and we are happy to be with you. Today we're presenting young folks both from the Bay Area and also from Philadelphia. So we're covering both sides of the country today. These are just a slice of the many, many young folks that are making change in our world right now. And just a little tiny piece is to whet your appetite of the work that we're doing, the work that they are doing, the work that we deeply believe in. From the top corner, these are the brilliant people you'll be hearing from today. There's Keish Datz with the beautiful orange background behind their beautiful image. Keish is a Black activist who does multimedia work. Below her, holding up an origami butterfly that we are going to learn from today, is Kaya Marbin, who is the founder of the Butterfly Effect. Next to Kaya is Isha Clark, who is one of the co-founders of Youth Versus the Apocalypse, and is also a company member with Destiny Center for the Arts. And next to Isha is Summer Blake, and Summer is a part of PhillyCam and also a multimedia artist, really working on representation along with so many things. So we are really thrilled to have you all here today. And Kenny, we're gonna skip ahead and move to our first presenter today, which will be Kaya, because we're waiting on Isha. Isha, have you joined us? I see that you just texted me. So maybe you're in there, in our land of peace.
I'm here. I've been here for a little bit.
Oh my God, honey. I am so sorry. Okay. Let's bring you up and let's go back. I'm sorry, Kenny, to mess with you. First, we're going to go back to the original agenda because our brilliant and lovely Isha Clark is here. And we're going to share with you a little quick video about Isha's work. And then we're going to hear from Isha. And basically that's how it's going to go. We're going to either hear or see a little bit of our young folks and their work, either in video or an audio piece. And then we're going to hear a little bit about them. And then we're going to learn from them and we're going to ask them some questions. And now I'm going to be quiet and we're going to hear about Isha.
We have been ignoring climate change for over 50 years, and now we're all at a point where no one can ignore it because it's impacting every single person. Everyone has been watching the natural disasters on TV. The climate crisis is the physical manifestation of all of the systems of oppression, which are the foundation of our society. This belief and practice that people are disposable and that people can be exploited for the benefit of one group of people. That is what white supremacy is. That is what colonialism is. That's what capitalism is. That's what patriarchy is. That's what ableism is. All of these systems are about devaluing human life.
We will no longer live in a world with white supremacy.
Youth Versus Apocalypse is a climate justice organization that is based in the Bay, that is run by frontline youth, you know, with some adult support. At the very core of our work is restoring humanity and simply claiming that no one is disposable, that all are worthy, and that we should be able to live in a world where everyone can thrive.
Stop! Tonight, our planet is dying!
Social justice is a really core value in my family. One of my earliest memories is probably listening to my grandpa tell me stories of his activism, going down south when he was in college to be a part of the civil rights movement. I think that he was one of my earliest influences. That really became a part of who I am very early on. The moment that really brought me to this climate justice movement was when I was a freshman in high school. I was invited to this action targeting Phil Tagami, who is a very prominent developer in Oakland, who is trying to build a coal terminal in West Oakland, a community that is mostly Black working class people and has been that for decades. This fight isn't about saving the rainforest and the polar bears, it's about people. And it's about people in my community, people who I love, getting years taken off of their lives because of this practice of racism and economic exploitation. In that moment, I recognized the power of speaking truth to power with that very same group of young people, all of color from Oakland, grew Youth Versus Apocalypse. It's about completely reimagining the way that we live in this world, moving away from this idea that people are disposable. And in order to do that, we have to dismantle the things that are keeping us from that, the things that are keeping us all conditioned in this society to hurt each other, to exploit each other. And so we started organizing climate strikes.
I believe that we will win. I believe that we will win.
In action, allyship looks like supporting the leadership of people who are on the front lines, people who are experiencing these systems that are quite literally causing the destruction of our planet. We can and will win. And we have been able to create such a beautiful movement. And this is only the beginning.
Thanks. Let's throw the spotlight onto Isha and hear from Isha.
Cool. Hey, y'all. I just want to say in advance, I apologize for my Wi-Fi. It's been tripping in the past couple days. So I apologize if I'm in and out. And I also just want to, you know, acknowledge where we are in the world in this time. I feel like it's easy, you know, now that people are starting to get vaccinated and the world is starting to open back up, quote unquote. But I really just want to acknowledge that this is still a really intense time and there's still a lot going on for so many people. And so I've just had a day. And so I felt like I just wanted to acknowledge that and really like call in and acknowledge that other people may have had some days or some weeks or some months, you know? And I'm just sending love to everyone and appreciate everyone for showing up today and just continuing to breathe and live and be. So yeah, I'm Isha. I graduated from high school last year. And this year I'm in my gap year before I start at Howard University in the fall, which is super exciting. And yeah, I am an organizer for collective liberation. Some people call me a climate justice activist, but I don't really like that title because I feel like for me, climate justice and really the work that I do is about fighting for all people in like the least corny way possible and recognizing, you know, that everything that we're experiencing right now, the societal breakdown that we're living through, you know, whether it be the pandemic or, you know, the recession or, you know, to name any of the other crises we've experienced in this year and beyond, you know, that breakdown is because our world, our society is built on top of a foundation of white supremacy and colonialism and capitalism and patriarchy and ableism. And all of these systems are one, unsustainable ways of living in the world. And two, at their root are about devaluing life, are about exploiting people, exploiting the planet. And that is an unsustainable way of existing as a living being in this life, in this world, you know? And so climate justice and the work that I'm doing is about tearing down, dismantling all of those systems and recognizing that that is the work that is necessary to stop climate change. That is the work that's necessary to, you know, live in a world in which all people can thrive. Because at the end of the day, you know, that's what we all want, right? I mean, like, everyone wants to be able to go beyond surviving. And I think that, that's really what my work is about. And so I organize with Youth Versus Apocalypse, which is a frontline youth-led climate justice organization based in the Bay Area. I'm very proud of that organization. We really built it up from the ground up. And I'm also an artist, and I'm a dancer and a poet. And I'm also an aspiring filmmaker. I've gotten into film this year, which has been really, really cool. So yeah, that's me. And honestly, like, I'm losing track of time. I'm not sure how long I'm supposed to talk, but really that truly is me. That is who I am, a person, a being in this life who is dedicated to collective liberation and healing and beauty and the fight for all life to be able to thrive. So thank you for allowing me into this space.
Thank you so much, Isha. Can I just ask you to tell the Dianne Feinstein story really quickly before we move on?
Sure. So when I was, I think I was a junior in high school at that time. And actually the Oakland teachers in the Oakland Unified School District were on strike. And so I like didn't have school during that time. And I was invited to an action in San Francisco that was in front of Senator Dianne Feinstein's office. And so I like spoke at the action, and then after, there was a bunch of young people there who wanted to present a letter to Senator Feinstein asking her to vote yes on the Green New Deal. And for those of you who don't know, the Green New Deal is a plan that has some legislation attached to it, but really like is an idea that is trying to shift the U.S. from, you know, an economy based in destruction and exploitation into one that is just and equitable and green in like a sentence. That's what it is. And so we were asking her to vote yes on that resolution. And there was this viral interaction that happened that some of you may have seen. This was February 2019. And that it got like 10 million views on Twitter and was like all over national and international, I think actually media. And so that was sort of a moment that really shifted the platform that Youth Versus Apocalypse had, and also, you know, myself as an organizer. Yeah.
Thank you so much for sharing that, Isha. Next, we're gonna see a quick little video about Kaya's work.
Something is happening in our country right now today that needs our attention
and our activism.
I'm Kaya and I'm 11.
I'm Lily and I'm 10.
And together we started the Butterfly Effect. We wanted to stand up for immigrant families so people would realize just how many children are being held in detention centers. So we started the Butterfly Effect.
We decided to make one butterfly for each of the 15,000 immigrant children in the detention centers at the border.
Imagine what would happen if we all made butterflies as a way of standing up for kids in detention centers.
Yo, yo. Until you're free, I'll be learning about your life and rights. Looking out for what you need, working to adjust my sights. See, until you're free, I'll be stepping up physically, putting focus on the real pick, taking responsibility. I'm not trying to live in the world that wants to remove you. I'm trying to be in a place with space to include you. We out here playing by rules that muffle the truth, which eventually becomes soundproof. Say it loud.
I'm the one standing up.
I'm the one standing up.
I'll be lifting you up.
I'll be lifting you up.
I will never slow down.
I will never slow down.
No better time than now.
No better time than now.
I'm not free until you're free.
That the time is now, that we got the power. Stand up side by side, impossible to break us down.
Time's up, dream, time's up, speak. Time's up, lead, time's up, believe.
That the time is now, that we got the power. Stand up side by side, impossible to break us down.
We can make a bigger voice.
Yeah.
We can make it twice as loud.
Yeah.
We can make a better choice.
Yeah.
We can be proud.
Ven conmigo y alcemos una sola voz. Que se escuche en cada esquina de este mundo. Tú decides, puedes elegir mejor. Sentir orgullo de lo que logramos juntos.
Now is the time though. Yeah, but you gon' need some spine though. Yeah, mean you gon' need some backbone. We lost love, it's time to find it, bring it back home. Turn the lights on, where the lights at? Your presence is a present. It's time to fight back, stand up, stand out. Do everything but stand down. Have heart, play your part, do what you can now. The future ain't no mystery. Choices dictate everything that you finna see. You either spectate or you create. You either at the table or be what's on the plate.
Somos más fuertes cuando nos unimos. Ser solidarios es lo que elegimos. No se trata de lo mío, no se trata de lo tuyo. Yo te apoyo, doy mi mano, lo hago con orgullo.
I'm not free, until you're free. We will be louder and stronger together.
Are we free if you're not?
That the time is now, that we got the power. Stand up side by side, impossible to break us down.
Time's up, dream, time's up, speak. Time's up, lead, time's up, believe.
That the time is now, that we got the power. Stand up side by side, impossible to break us down.
Thank you. That was Kaya's piece. Kaya, share a little bit about yourself and your amazing work.
Hi, I'm Kaya. I am now 13 years old, and I'm going to tell you a little bit about the project. The idea for the Butterfly Effect started about 2 years ago when I was listening to the radio with my mom, and a story came on about kids in detention. And I asked her how many kids there were in detention, and she didn't know. So we looked it up, and it turned out there were about 15,000 children in detention. And that was just like a crazy number that blew my mind. But it didn't really sink in with me. And 15,000 is a big number, but it's hard to imagine 15,000 kids. So I thought that if it didn't sink in with me, and it didn't really sink in with my family, it probably didn't sink in with a lot of people. And I thought if people saw what 15,000 looked like, it might make an emotional connection and motivate them to do something. And I knew that it wasn't fair that kids were in cages. So I called my friend Lily, who couldn't be here today. And we decided that since the adults weren't doing enough, then we needed to get involved. So we decided to make 15,000 butterflies to represent the 15,000 kids. These are butterflies behind me. We chose butterflies because they represent hope love and friendship. And some butterflies, like monarchs, migrate from California, where I am, to Mexico. And one of our key things was to make sure the project was kid-led and that kids were the main decision makers. And so we had meetings every Sunday to make decisions about the project and make butterflies. Our community was able to make about like over 50,000 butterflies. And in November, in November 2019, we had a big rally at Lake Merritt that you saw in the video, where we displayed the 15,000 butterflies. There was talking, singing, dancing, and we asked people to send postcards to both kids in detention centers and their elected officials, and we helped people register to vote. About a week after that, almost 40 youth activists and adult allies went to Washington, D.C. at the invitation of Senator Jeff Merkley from Oregon. And we walked the halls of the Senate delivering butterflies and our message to let them know what was happening about the kids in the border and to let them know that we cared. And at one of our meetings, we met with the senator's lead immigration counsel. She started by telling us this story. Before her job in DC, she was an immigration attorney. And on her first visit to a detention center, a child came up to her and said, "Does anyone know we're here?" Many of the adults started crying, but that moment sparked the kids. This is why we were there. So we all piped up to say, "Yes, we know you're there and we're fighting for you." That afternoon, all the teams met up for a press conference that had been set up by the Congressional Hispanic Caucus with Congresswoman Barbara Lee, Judy Chu, and Speaker Nancy Pelosi. We got to share our message with an even bigger audience and hear from all the powerful people about what they were doing. In 2020, we had planned to travel to the southern border to show our support for the kids there, but COVID stopped us. And since we weren't able to travel, we've continued to make butterflies and give talks to help remind people of the children who are separated from their parents and that we need to have more immigration policies that are kind and humane. I've learned a lot from everybody and everything from this project, but one thing that will stick with me throughout the rest of my activism, even when I'm an adult, is that kids can make a difference. Being a kid doesn't limit you. It frees you to imagine and dream, think the unthought, say what you want to say. And people don't expect a kid to stand up for something that they believe in. So when kids do stand up, people are taken by surprise, and sometimes that's an advantage. Sometimes people say, "We're just kids, we don't know what we're talking about," but we know the difference between right and wrong. And even though we're kids, we know we have to stand up for other people, even when it's hard.
Aya, thank you so much for that beautiful talk, saying so many powerful things. We're gonna get to covering more of those soon, and you're gonna also teach us how to make some butterflies, so yay. Next up, we are going to hear from, we're traveling across the country, and we're going to see a short video by our next young artist, Keish Datz, who is a Blacktivist working with Philly Cam and does multimedia work. So we are going to go to that video next.
When I think about representation, I think about all the fallen soldiers who won't ever get the chance to speak. When I think about representation, I think about how a lot of us will never get the chance to fulfill our dreams because we wake up in this trap, living in nightmares. Growing up in Southwest Philly, you kind of normalize the trauma until you get lucky enough to get a glimpse of what access looks like. I grew up always knowing I was non-binary and Black, but honestly, I didn't know I was poor. There's a lot of pain and trauma we go through when it comes to the way we police Black bodies, whether it's stop and frisk, Black masculinity, or sexuality. I don't know if I would call myself an artist rather than just someone who wants to use art as a way to help people learn and unlearn about my community. But regardless, I just want to show my people in the truest light possible.
Thank you for that. Kenny, can you throw the spotlight onto Keish so that we could hear? There we go. Keish, this was different in that yours, you created this. The other two were created on our young folks, and this one was actually your fresh off of the presses video that you just made. Can you tell us about who you are and about the video that you just made?
Yes, of course. Honestly, I had to turn my camera off and like my these speakers, because you know when you hear yourself playback, like, no, that wasn't it. So I'm like, I don't even know what I said. But what's up, everybody? My name is Keish. I am a 19-year-old Black activist. I don't even know what I'm saying, for real. But I guess, like, can't curse. Okay. So hold up. Wait. All right. So I guess, like, I'll tell you a little bit more about myself. So my name is Keish. I'm from Southwest Philly, which is Philadelphia. And the way, honestly, that I found, like, organizing space was, like, really my whole life, but I didn't have the language. So growing up, I was adopted by my great aunt, and she had PTSD, and I didn't know that she had PTSD, but I knew, like, I would hear, like, the talks about cops following her and just, like, constant things about, like, just the cops. And being adopted, I was also, I had a lot of run-ins with DHS. So whether that's DHS coming into my house, raiding it, and just me trying to figure out, like, what is happening, but I still didn't understand language. So growing up, as I said, I always knew I was non-binary, and I always felt really disconnected from, like, social constructs. So, like, that's, I guess, like, that still fed into my organizing space. But then it wasn't until the National School Walkout, when I walked out a school, that I found organizers. And it was, like, really lucky, because the schools that I went to was, like, all Black and just, like, really ran down. And these organizations aren't coming into these, like, these different schools presenting themselves. And so, like, when I actually went to the walkout, I met this lady named Saudia, and she was a part of this organization called the Philadelphia Student Union. At the Philadelphia Student Union, this is at a time where I was, like, I was pretty shy, and, like, I would get bullied. And I didn't really know a lot of big terms like capitalism. And so when I went inside of this room, I would hear people talk about socialism, capitalism. And I'm like, I'm just looking back, like, I'm just like, what? Like, cause it's like these words are so foreign, but it's like everything just start clicking when you start understanding language. And I think that's what really informs my organizing is just like lived experience. Like, I don't really know. It's like, you can't go to school for this. You can't go to school for, like, your friend getting shot and you hearing it, and then there's fireworks, and the fireworks feel like gunshots through your body. You can't go to school, like, for this. It's like, yes, we understand the language, but I guess I don't really know what, like, the talking points I would go into, but I'm pretty new in, like, in the art world, actually. And I did this program called Arts to Work. And as a Black non-binary person that's, like, from a low income place, it's actually hard trying to navigate this art world that is so, like, whitewashed. Cause it's like, when you talk about human rights, people, like, try to make it seem like you're pushing an agenda. And then you also have, like, white people trying to tell your own stories. And I'm just, like, being blunt, it's like white people trying to tell Black stories. And so, yeah, I think the thing that I worry about most when it comes to the film space is the idea that we try to make white people comfortable, and we try to make these different groups comfortable. And that's, like, actually something I'm working through now. And we don't actually go into the community, and we don't give voice because we're scared that, or, like, I guess, like, film directors and people are scared that they're putting, like, their identity on the line, or they can't tell an authentic story. But I think that when it comes to different communities that's not yours, whether that's the trans community, the queer community, any community that's not yours, the disabled community, we need to make sure we give access to these people. We need to make sure when they're, like, speaking and they say how they feel, we need to really respect their voice. And honestly, like, I don't know what to say, because, like, a lot of this work is, like, really just lived experience.
But it's, yeah, I think that, like, yeah, I mean, like, I feel like I'm going over time, but like I was saying, I just think that we need to highlight these people. Like my friend, like, I've lost so many friends this year to gun violence. And it's like, people don't understand, like, I can tell my whole story and people like think this is crazy, but like, no, this is like really just like, it becomes so normalized. So I think we need to like get out our own spaces and go and talk to these people and stop feeling comfortable. I feel like you can't be conscious and be comfortable at the same time. That's why I really commend people that are into direct action, because it's like a lot of people, you want to like, you can post stuff on Instagram, but you're scared to go around Black people. You're scared to go into these different neighborhoods. So I feel like, last point I'll make is like, we need to abolish capitalism. And like, Isha, I love what they're and she's doing, because like, abolition is sustainability outside of the system. And so I feel like we all need to get to a place where we're not scared to be uncomfortable and give up our privilege. But yeah, I don't know what I was saying, but just take it how you want it. Thank you.
Thank you, Keish, for dropping the knowledge and sharing your wisdom with us. We really appreciate it. And a bit of what you were talking about was sharing our own stories. And so next we're going to hear from Summer, who's talking about a little bit around that too. Summer Blake, who we're going to, can I pull up the next slide and show, there's the beautiful Summer right there. And we're going to hear some of an audio, a piece of a longer interview that Summer did with the amazing actor from Bridgerton. So we're going to listen to that for a moment.
Okay, so hi. Again, my name is Summer. It's so nice to meet you.
Likewise. So tell me, why did you want to talk to me?
So the main connection that I think we both have is that we're both in the arts industry. When I was in high school, I was a theater major, so I got really into acting. And then through my theater major program at my school, I got really into like film, but also did like out of school stuff. So a lot of the questions really do relate to like people of color and representing people of color in the arts industry as a whole, but specifically for you as an actress and in the acting world. And yeah, so I think that's mainly what our conversation is going to be about for today, unless there was something like else that you wanted to add to that conversation.
This is your conversation. You have it how you want it.
Okay. Okay. So just to start off, so I'm 18 now. And so I just want to know just like some basic things. What were you like when you were 18?
I was very smart. I started school at 4. They put me into the juniors at 6. You weren't supposed to go up till 7. So I went right through primary school a year ahead, which was great for my smartness and my showy offness. It was less great when I got to secondary school. And even though I'd been with that same peer group right through my primary school, secondary school is junior high, I guess. Mm-hmm. Emotionally, I was a year younger. Doesn't matter what my brain was doing. Emotionally, I was a year younger. Mm-hmm. So I always felt like I was slightly behind all the time. You know, I felt slightly behind, even though if you'd said, you know, do this bit of grammar or let's do this bit of algebra, I'd have been like, tss. If it was about, you know, being around other girls who were being a bit, you know, or being around boys, I just didn't know what to do apart from fight them or pull a stupid face or something. So I think I learned performative defensive skills early on. So I sat what we call our A levels, which are the exams you take before you go to university or some sort of further education. I took them at 17. Everybody else was taking them at 18. I was 17. I sat my A levels then. I was, as I say, I was a smart kid. So I was studying to go to Oxford or Cambridge to read law. I had a nervous breakdown in the sixth form because my parents were divorced. I was anorexic. There was too much work going on. There was too much life going on, and I couldn't hold it all together. So I had nervous breakdown in the sixth form. I did so badly in my A levels. It was, I can't tell you. I didn't go to Cambridge that year to read law. But what I did do was I left school. I won't use the salty language that I used about school at the time, but I left school. I moved out of home. I moved in with a friend of my mother's in the nearest big city, and I went to a college there and I resat those exams because I was furious at my grades. I was a punk when I was 14, which saved my life because I suddenly met a whole bunch of other weirdo kids who I could just be me with. So all the kids that were sort of.
So this is a tiny piece of Summer Blake's much longer piece with the amazing actor. Summer, tell us about yourself and why you also selected to share this with us.
So hi everyone. My name is Summer. I'm located right outside of Philadelphia in an area called Montgomery County. And I think I wanted to share this piece because it was the first piece that I actually got to talk to someone who is in the arts industry and who is, I think is just such an amazing person overall. I got to know her a little bit before the interview. And then as I interviewed her, I just learned a lot more about her. As you guys heard, she has the best stories to tell all the time, and she's just a really great person. But to kind of give you some more background about me first, I think most of my arts experiences started when I was in Philly CAM, which is a organization that is located in Philadelphia. And they teach students how to do like podcasts and making films. And sometimes I think they had a music program at one point, and they also have a photography program. And I participated in the film and the documentary program. And that's kind of where I got my kind of like podcast and filming skills from. Representation kind of became a huge thing to me when I was in, I want to say, eighth grade. I was asked to be a part of the podcasting program. It was the first year that they were doing it. And we, all the students that were part of that program received the opportunity to go to the March for Our Lives march that was happening that year, which was marching against gun violence in schools. And while I was in that march, I enjoyed the fact that I was a part of something that was trying to produce some sort of change. And it was the first time that I was ever a part of a march. I had never been a part of something like that. So to go to a march and also have to interview people there was an interesting experience for me. But what I realized while I was there, though, was that everyone was there marching for gun violence in schools. And I'd realized that gun violence wasn't really something that started in schools. It was something that kind of really started mainly in low-income people of color neighborhoods. And even though I didn't have any personal experiences with that, I never have, but I could empathize with the fact that this was an issue that didn't start in schools. It wasn't an issue that started with children in schools. And even though that it's still a horrible situation, it shouldn't happen anywhere. I realized that people of color, especially Black people, have been dealing with that for years, years before March for Our Lives even existed, years before all of these gun violence issues happened in schools. And I think that was the beginning of me realizing that representation for Black people is so important and our voices need to be heard in so many different areas that it's almost ridiculous. And so going back to the interview with Adjua, I think speaking with her was really kind of something that I needed in a way that was, I needed that contact with someone who could give me advice, but I could still get information from her and I could still just have a regular conversation with her and relate to her in a way where I'm young and I'm trying to get into the arts industry and she's, you know, older and very successful, but she's, you know, in the arts industry now and she can provide so many tips, so much information that would be so useful for me. And I think I needed that one-on-one contact, especially with someone like her, as open as she is as a person. I feel like she's really someone who's, no matter what status she's ever going to be at, she's always just going to be this really open person who wants to talk to anyone. So that's kind of what that conversation was about, and really her role in being a representation of Black people that did exist during the time period that Bridgerton is based in. And I think that there's a lot of back and forth between, you know, if people of color were actually, you know, of royalty during that time, and if that really existed and everything. And honestly, I think there's historical facts that prove that there was, but I think that is a conversation that will continue to be questioned. I'm not really sure why that ever really would be, because I think that the facts are there, but that's definitely an ongoing conversation. And yeah, so I'm really into film mainly. I'm getting more into doing podcasts and interviews, and representation is my thing. And I really want to, in my presentation later, I really want to talk more about allyship as well, because I think during this pandemic, we've had to experience and witness a lot of things that have happened to people of color that I think a lot of people don't understand exactly sometimes how to be an ally to those groups and exactly what that means to be an ally. And honestly, I think the root of allyship is really just having empathy. You have to empathize with the people who are experiencing these things, and you have to empathize with the people who have to always be in fear of something happening to them, or always be in fear that they're not going to be given an opportunity just because of the color of their skin or just because of the group that they were born into. And yeah, I don't really have anything else left to say. Thank you.
Thank you, Summer. Summer gave a little teaser there. Kaya's gonna show us all how to fold butterflies so that we could actually be a part of the butterfly effect. And then we're gonna go for some questions and answers with them all, a little panel. And then after that, Summer and Keish will lead some hands-on, but let's work with Kaya.
Hi, everybody. I have a square piece of paper. You should too. If you don't have a square piece of paper, you can take a regular piece of paper. Sorry, I doodled all over this one. And you can fold it so that it's like that, so that it has this, you just fold it. And then you somehow remove this part. It's kind of hard when I'm holding it in the air, but it's like that. And then you remove this part and I rip it because I feel like that's easier for me, but you can cut it if you want. Then you end up with a square piece of paper. So the first thing you want to do is you take it and fold it corner to corner, and you want the pattern that you want on the outside. So corner to corner. Then you open it, other corner to other corner. And now I have two diagonal lines. Then I want to fold it in half so the pattern is on the inside. This. Then I open it and it's like that. And this bottom part right here, you just want to push it out so it makes like a little tent. And then these two flappy parts down here, you smush them together and then like that. And I can do that one more time. Like that and like that. So now you have a mouth. I call it a mouth because I kind of imagine it chomping. But then there are four flaps here, and you take one of the flaps
and you fold it up. And then take the other flap and you fold it up. So now it looks like that. Then gonna flip it. And then there's this back part here. And you wanna lift up only the back part. So there are still these wings down below. And this line, you wanna fold it so the tip of this goes over the line. So looks like that. Then you turn it around and the tip you fold down. And then you just fold it in half. And ta-da, you've made a butterfly.
Can you share with people about after they've folded a butterfly, what can they do with them to get involved with your work?
Yeah, you can check out our website, and I think I saw it in the chat. And I'm pretty sure there's an address in there. Or you could also make more and send them to your elected officials and say the immigration policies need to change and you're the one who can do something about it. So, yeah.
Thank you for that, Kaya. Kenny, can you help me put a spotlight on all of our young presenters right now? And I just wanna throw out some questions for y'all. And just to have everybody ask, because our audience is amazing, teaching artists, mentor artists. So I'd love for each of you to just share how a mentor artist in your life has helped you to grow and what impact they've had on you. And Isha, because you went first, I just wanna start with you and hear from you.
Sorry, I missed the beginning of that. It was about like if a...
Your mentor, the teaching artist in your life. So I think that's Sarah with yeah. you and the impact they've had on your life.
Yeah.
What skills, what lessons have they taught you?
You know, I've been really blessed to have a lot of really amazing mentors in my life, especially artist mentors. So I became a part, and I also shout out Aliza. I saw Aliza in the chat. Shout out Destiny. But I started at Destiny Arts Center in Oakland. The first time I was ever there, I took teddy bear classes, and I was like probably 4 or 5. I was super young. And then I came back when I was about like 8 or 9, and I joined their junior company. And Destiny Arts is, I always have a hard time explaining what it is because it's just like so many things. But it's like this youth development center that really focuses on using art to inspire social change. And so, you know, the two main things that they have are dance and martial arts, but they also, you know, have theater programs and like, you know, a bunch of really amazing things. And through their two performance companies, one their junior company and the other one their youth performance company, which is for ages 13 to 18, you really like learn, you're in a pre-professional company and, you know, you're learning how to be in a dance company, how to, you know, learn choreography, but also how to create and how to create art that really, again, is meant to inspire social change. And so that is my foundation. And I've always understood art as, you know, a method of change making and organizing and, yeah, so my mentors there were like Sarah Kroll, Rashidi Omari, Mika Lemoyne, Samara Atkins, like, you know, Paula Dewar, like so many people there that really each had a different impact on me. I'm not like fully sure how to answer the question because I feel like I won't be able to accurately like do justice to everybody, you know. But I think that having those mentors hold that space for me. So as a young person, I could come be with other young people and share space, build community, be able to, like, you know, release whatever was happening in life at that moment and, like, you know, be able to create and say something and have the technical tools and the, like, you know, love and community to be able to do that was really important for me.
Cool, thanks. What about you, Kaya? How have teaching artists in your life helped you to grow? What skills or lessons have you learned?
So I have a lot, but there's one that I specifically want to share, who is my aunt Caitlin. And I'm a super shy person. And when I was little, I never talked to anybody. I took a ballet class at one point and I hid in the corner the whole class. And my parents were like, why are we paying for this? And so then I'm just a very shy person. And I still am. I'm less shy now. But my aunt Caitlin, she somehow got through to me and taught me the importance of speaking up and how if you speak up, things might actually change. And she supports me and she gives me room to talk. And yeah.
Thank you for that. I love that. What about you, Keish?
Oh yeah, definitely. I always think it's like a weird paradox that like my favorite teachers weren't like teachers that were inside of like a school system. It's just like, it's like a waste of time. Like, actually, if you went to school, it's not a waste of time, but actually, it is, whatever, take it how you want it. But I remember when I first like started getting to organizing space after the walkout, after PSU, I ended up basically getting like being pushed into like doing organizing work. So we held an event at the William Way Center, and which is downtown Philly, which is basically a queer organization. And we had to do I basically had this table and like talk to people about like the school to prison pipeline. And I'm like, I'm not the like person's like, sorry. And so there was actually the guy that was sitting at that table. We each got paired with like a mentor. He wanted me to like be a part of his organization. And this is like still at a time where I felt like, you know, my experience are valid. I don't really know the correct language. Like these people like have been organizing for years. So I don't know if I'm really qualified. So I ended up joining his organization. And one thing he said to me is that never let your outside atmosphere determine your inside climate. That was the best quote that I heard like in my life. And that kind of shifted a paradox. Actually, that's what words am I using? That like shifted like my world for me. And, you know, there I also met a mentor named Dunder, who is queer. And the first time I heard the word non-binary, queer, and all these different words were through organizations. And so I think that not only did it help me like come to myself, mentors come to myself, but it also allowed me to realize that like I am like, it's not about qualifications, but it's like everybody's experiences is valid. And that I honestly think it's like a thing where it's like you go to school and you can't really protest against your teachers. Like you can't be like this question has the wrong answer, so let me put this answer because this is the right answer, because like you're gonna fail. But it's like, and it's like within your body and within yourself, you kind of associate like protesting against authority figures with something that's like you can't do it. And so I feel like I'm just like really thankful for the adults and the mentors who held space for me at a time where I felt like I couldn't like pull back, where I couldn't like really have my voice heard. So I think like that's the most important thing, that no matter where you are, no matter how old you are, no matter like what experience you have, no matter who you are, your voice is valid. I think that's like the most like the best thing that I've learned.
Thank you for that. Your voice is valid. Thank you. Summer, what about you?
Well, to just give like a short background, from the time I was in elementary school to high school, I always went to a predominantly white school. So I was never really surrounded by a lot of teachers who were of color. I never really got to see someone of color always teaching me. And I think that was kind of a problem for me as I started to grow up and I got older and I really started to realize who was actually teaching me this information that I needed to know for the rest of my life and for like the real world. But when I got to high school, I'd switched districts and I went to an art school. I went to a charter art school. And there was this one teacher there and his name was his name was Chet Brown. We can call him by his first name now. He always says that to us now. But his name was Chet Brown and he was the only teacher of color in the entire school. But we always had a very close relationship, like us, me and all the other kids of color, all of like the Black kids and him. We had a very close relationship with him because every year we put on the Black History Month show. And during my junior and senior year, my junior year, I was the stage manager of the show. And then my senior year, I was the director of the show. And it was the best experience ever. I look forward to it literally every year. And I think overall, he was really just someone who kind of always told me, like, don't listen to like these other people, like, just do what you want to do, however you want the show to look, make it look that way. Whatever you want the show to be about, make it that way. Like, don't think about these other people. It doesn't matter how many people or how much of a minority you actually are in the space. It really doesn't matter. And just always just express whatever it is that you want to express for this show, because it's about us and it's about like our arts and it's about our culture. And he was always really inspirational, because even away from the show, he was always really cool to talk to. And like, he was just a really cool teacher to have while I was there. And sadly, the year that I left, he actually left the school. So I'm happy that I got all 4 years of high school with him. And I didn't get to miss a year. So I feel bad for the kids that missed this year with him, but I got all 4 years. So I feel lucky.
Yay. You all have touched on this a little bit, which is around what are the elements that make a really good mentor artist or a teacher, somebody that inspires you, somebody that sees you and meets you where you're at. Are there some other things, and this is just for anybody, that you'd like to add to that, that you think, what is it that makes a really good teaching artist? Or what are some of the things that you wish that teachers could do to help guide you and to help understand you? Anybody can talk about this if you want.
Since I'll say something, I feel like if you aren't somebody of their same identity, you don't have to like fake or like, I don't know how to explain it. You don't have to like act like you know how to maneuver. I think like it's okay to reach out to other people that might have the same identity of the people, like the person you're like mentoring, and ask them for advice. Like it's okay to have a mentor that doesn't look like you. But I think that like you want to like understand them and like just show that you care, because like for me, somebody like me, I'm now starting to meet more and more white men. And like this is like me being like really real. And this is me being real. And it's like, I don't know if I can trust a white man, because like I associate white men with police. And this is like what people really like are thinking. And so I had to do unlearning myself and like just understand like there might be like certain biases within like both parties, but it's like work with them together and like be honest to the person you're talking to. Like just be honest about how you feel, how you see them, and ask them how they see you ultimately. Like ask the person, like if somebody would have asked me how I see them, I probably would have opened up, but make sure the space that you're holding for them is comfortable enough for them to let their guard down.
Thank you for that. So deep. Anybody else want to add to that?
I have a couple of things. I feel like something that Keish said that's really important is like really recognizing that at the end of the day, it's about creating space and about really like caring for like the young person as a full human, you know, and like as a full person and just recognizing that, like the humanity piece and like the compassion and all of that. But another thing for me, in my like creating in my art, authenticity and truth are like the most important things. And I feel like the greatest gift that a teaching artist can give is like, helping a young person or helping like a mentee to find their own authentic, truthful voice and story. And you can't do that by telling them what their story is, you know, it's by like giving space, giving tools to express and like, you know, nurturing. And, you know, you can tell when someone is being 100% authentic and true, and just like helping that to come out. Yeah.
I love these wisdom words from y'all. Kaya and Summer, I'm also being really aware of time and we still want to get to the exercises. Kaya and Summer, do you want to add to that?
Yeah, I can add a short point. It's kind of going off of Isha and Keish, but I think overall, you know, if you're not a part of a specific community, like if you can't represent, I don't know, for example, if you can't represent Black kids because you're white, you know, you don't have to always feel like you have to say, I understand everything that you're going through, because in actuality, you don't know what that feels like. You don't know what it feels like to be a young Black kid in a predominantly white school. That is not your experience, but it's okay to listen to what that experience is like. It's okay to say, I can feel how that could be, you know, lonely, or like I could feel how that could be, you know, kind of demeaning in a way. And that's okay. It's okay to empathize with the story, but it's not always going to be something that you completely understand. And that's okay, because it's just not your experience. Everybody's experience is different. And, you know, like Keish has an experience that I don't have, you know, like I didn't grow up in a neighborhood where gun violence was super relevant. That's not where I come from, but I can empathize with that because I know that gun violence is real. And I know that there are people like Keish who actually are living in neighborhoods who experience that. And yeah, that's my point.
Thanks. Kaya, do you want to add anything?
No, that's okay. I think what everybody else said was really good, and I don't think I could say anything nearly as good as them.
Thank you all. Really powerful. We're gonna move into Summer's exercise with us on representation.
Okay, cool. So my representation consists of just a few photos. I think I sent in three. And I want you guys to share exactly the first words that you guys feel when you first look at these photos. And then I'll kind of go more in depth on why I went to this exercise in the end. Miko, am I sharing? Or?
No, Kenny, can you pull up the screen?
Okay. Okay, cool. So when you look at this photo here, what is the first thing that you think of? Or the first two, three things?
Summer, you want everyone to just throw it in the chat?
Yeah, sure. I think people have started to do that. Yeah. I love being in a space with a bunch of artists because a lot of these words are really actually what the story is. Okay, cool. Okay, so this story, this is an image of a 24-year-old Black male who's experiencing creativity block. He has a project that he has to complete in the next 2 days and doesn't know what to do. So that was this first photo. And then we can move on to the next one.
Summer, can we just do one more because of the time? So can
Sure, definitely. That's
one,
fine.
Do you want to do this one or the next one?
Let's actually do the last one.
Okay.
Okay. And then again, just say whatever words come to mind when you look at this picture. Cool. Great. So this story, this is an image of a 29-year-old woman who's a writer. While in the middle of trying to finish her story, she gets fired because her boss said that her story is no longer relevant. She still believes in the story that she is trying to write, and she wants to continue finding the pieces she needs to complete it. So with these photos and these stories that are attached to them, I wanted to show in a different kind of way how being an ally to something, being an ally to a group or just what an organization is trying to do, it's not about having to say, like I said before, it's not about having to say, I understand what this person is going through. It's not about saying, I know what that experience is like when you don't know what that experience is like. And at times I think we can tell from the outside how people are actually feeling, especially if it's in a certain space. So if you see a kid walking around a school and they look really sad, you know, they're probably experiencing something where maybe they've been bullied. Maybe they feel singled out. Maybe they feel lonely. Maybe they just feel like they're in their own type of box and they don't know exactly where they fit in. And it's not about having to make an assumption, but it's more about having a empathetic motivation to want to understand what that person is going through. And I think that's the root of allyship. I didn't want to make that too long because I know we're on a time crunch, but I think that's kind of what I wanted to conclude with this presentation and kind of my overall narrative.
Thanks so much, Summer. We're going to move into Keish on policing bodies.
Okay, but I don't. Yeah, so this, honestly, I feel like it's really important to include trans, non-binary, and people who are queer in storytelling. If you're like cis or just not, don't identify with like either sexuality or gender, it's okay. I think like we have to like be more considerate to like give our space, like give our access up to those people, like make them the directors, the producers, and stuff like that, just so their communities can like see their representation. And so like I wanted to do a writing prompt about how we police our own bodies, because I think that like to empathize with others, we have to empathize with ourselves first. And so I don't know if we have enough time to like think about this, but I would like for like just people that are like here to like, if you want to volunteer and like talk about that for about, okay, I don't know, for like, 11, yeah, like if you want, anybody want to like talk about like how they police their own bodies and like their journey with that. But yeah, any volunteers?
Should we get everybody just a couple of minutes so that they could write a little bit on this first?
Okay, yes.
Keisha, a question has come up in the chat for you.
Who do I prefer to speak? I would like for like people who are trans, for us to hold space for them first, and then
yeah, but whoever wants to go, it doesn't, that honestly doesn't matter. But just like be aware, like, that we should be holding space. Yes. Yes to the last question.
Eli has volunteered to speak, Keish, is that okay?
Of course, yes, thank you.
Eli, I think you need to unmute yourself. Let's find you and we'll see if we could spotlight you.
Is that working?
Okay, try again.
I feel like we heard you for a second.
Right.
Hello?
Yes, we can hear you.
Okay. Hi, I'm Eli or Elijah, doesn't really matter. I'm a non-binary trans mask individual. And I think like with this question, it's a little harder for me to answer because I'm not entirely believing in the concept of heaven and hell, but I did grow up in a Christian environment. And growing up in that environment, it was very hard for me to identify as what I believed I was, because I always knew since I was very little that I wasn't a cis female, but I had my environment controlling what I could do with myself, what I could present as, what I could dress with, and all of that, and I think it negatively impacted how I viewed my body when I was younger, because I thought I had to be this concept of a good Christian girl when that wasn't who I really believed I was. And I think that's a problem a lot of children will grow up with, especially in extremely religious environments, that they have to appease the whatever God they believe in or their parents, and they are not allowed to control their bodily autonomy. And I think that's just an issue in general with trans children especially. And I think that the concept of being punished for who you want to be as a child is something that a lot of kids have to deal with. And I think if there was a heaven or hell in my beliefs, I don't think you should be punished for what you're comfortable with. So I think that's what kids should be taught. They should be taught that they are allowed to choose what to do with their body, because just because they're children doesn't mean they can't consent to things like going through hormone blockers or going through hormone replacement therapy. I think if they're old enough to grasp that concept, they should be allowed to do that. And that's how I grew up. Like, I was not allowed to do that. And I think that's how it affected how I'm policing myself now. I'm transitioning now, but that's only because I eventually migrated to an environment where I was allowed to not be affected by something like heaven and hell. And I think that the concept of it will definitely affect how a child will grow up, if that makes sense.
Yes, definitely. Thank you so much for sharing that, and thank you for speaking. And I hope that everybody like heard what you said. And yes, thank you. And yeah, just like send them love your way. But yeah, I don't know if anybody else wants to speak on this, or like, even if you can't speak on this, like speak on how you as like a teacher could like deal with, like what are some like effective ways of dealing with people that might not share like the same identity or like belief system as you?
As the straight white guy, I might say something. I think a big part is, I think you guys have already said it, is meet people where they are and give them a space. And also, one of the things I wrote down for that last prompt is, it doesn't really connect with me, but it takes me back to my time in Japan when I lived overseas. And as a 6'3" gaijin, hearing car doors locked, being denied entry into restaurants, people crossing the street, you know, just remember whatever that is in your life and go, but I could go home. You know, I could always, and to think, oh my God, there are people that they can't go home from this, whatever. So it's not at all directly related, but anything you can use to empathize. And you don't even have to share that with them. Just anything you can use to empathize, and then just listen and give them a space. And I'm going to mute.
Thank you so much. Thank y'all for doing this with me. And yeah, thank you. Like, I'm like appreciative of hearing like both sides. And yeah, I'll pass it back to Nico.
We're going to do one more exercise, actually. We are almost out of time. And so actually, Keisha's going to lead us in one more exercise. If we can go to the next slide, I do believe, which is an affirmation. We're going to skip the panel. There we go. Keish, take us away. And I'll help you with the spotlighting thing.
Yeah, I honestly forgot like how I'm going to do this. Listen, I'm like, my memory is like, okay. But I guess like, I don't know. Okay, I guess everybody should just write an affirmation like in a chat. Yeah, I think that's the best way.
So everybody's gonna write an affirmation to yourself. You're actually gonna do it in the chat, not privately as it says on the screen.
Well, then it don't matter. I was saying it don't matter. Whatever's best.
And then we're gonna, Keisha's going to pick out a few people. We're going to spotlight that person. Yeah. And everybody's going to say that affirmation. Everybody will unmute and say that affirmation to that person. Right, Keish? Did I say that right?
Honestly, I'm like, I don't know. I don't know.
This is your exercise. This is how you told me.
Does anybody want to say an affirmation out loud and then we all can repeat it?
Summer, will you start us off?
Sure. So I'm supposed to, do I pick someone else's?
No, say your own.
Okay.
Can you put us back to gallery so we can see everyone? Everybody go into gallery view, and everybody that wants to reveal your beautiful faces, that's lovely. And Summer's gonna say her affirmation, and then everybody's gonna say back to Summer her affirmation.
Oh, okay, I love this. Okay, so my affirmation that I wrote to myself was to trust in myself more.
And Keish, we're all saying back to her, Summer, trust yourself more.
Trust yourself more.
Trust yourself more.
Trust yourself more.
Trust yourself.
Isha, you go.
I'm actually gonna take someone else's because I like that better. It was, I'm here and that is enough.
I am here and that is enough.
Everybody unmute and say to Isha, Isha,
you are here. You are enough.
Kaya, do you have one?
I just learned what an affirmation was 2 seconds ago. So, no, but I'll keep thinking about it.
Okay, love it. Keish, what about you?
I am worthy, I guess.
Everybody unmute.
This is awkward.
Keish, you are worthy.
Keish, you are worthy.
You are so worthy.
Thank you. I appreciate y'all.
Kaya, do you have one yet? We want to honor you in your time, so.
Well, thinking about what I just said, I am learning and I am growing.
Beautiful.
Everybody unmute. Kaya.
Kaya, you're growing.
Everybody give the most brilliant sign language applause to our young presenters who spread so much wisdom and knowledge for all of us. We appreciate you. We learn from you. We value you. Thank you so much for being here and joining us today. Thank you all to our audience for coming and attending, and to Pro Bono ASL. Thank you for your sign language. Thank you all for joining us at Teaching Artists Guild. Have a great day.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye, everyone. Thank you.
Thanks, all.
We should go out for pizza.